In this example, I'm going to be finding the confidence interval for the population mean when the standard deviation or sigma is unknown. The SAT scores of 12 randomly selected high school seniors is given. Find a 90% confidence interval for the population mean. Assume SAT scores are normally distributed. And I have the 12 scores listed here. Now, because it says that we are to assume the scores are normally distributed, this does not mean, pardon me, my cat just jumped on the table. This does not mean I'm going to be using the Z distribution. It means that the assumption has been met to appropriately use the T distribution for that critical value. All right, so the pieces we need will be the sample size. Okay, we have that. So the degrees of freedom will be 11 because the degrees of freedom is the sample size minus 1. We'll need alpha, specifically alpha over 2. Okay, but alpha right now for us is going to be 0.10 because our level of confidence is 0.9. Alpha is 0.10. And we're also going to need X bar, okay, and we'll find that in a minute. And we'll need S. Okay, so we'll need the sample mean and the sample standard deviation. So the formula for the confidence interval will be X bar plus or minus that critical value from the T table. Okay, so I'll just write that T value, and I'll go over again how to find that. Times S over the square root of N. All right, so let's talk about this T value briefly. So the T distribution is bell-shaped with a mean of 0. And I want, for this situation, I want 0.9 amount of area, my level of confidence between these two symmetric T values. So by symmetry, this will have alpha over 2, alpha being the amount of area left over together between the two tails. So alpha over 2 will be 0.05. And by symmetry, I'd also have 0.05 area here. All right, so alpha is 0.1. That's the sum of the area between the two tails, or it's the complement to the level of confidence. And half of alpha will be in each tail. So this piece here gives me the amount of area in that upper tail that helps me read the table. So to find that T value, I can go to that T table, and this particular T table reads from the critical value, the upper critical value, to positive infinity. So I'm reading down to 11 degrees of freedom and over to 0.05, and this print is very, very small. Okay, so 0.05, I have 1.796. Okay, so that this piece right here is 1.796. And I have my sample size that's given in the problem. Okay, I could also count the number of values in my data set. So the only two missing pieces are the sample mean and the sample standard deviation. I've already entered the 12 values into my calculator under the stat menu. Just to reiterate, that would be stat and then edit. Okay, so I put all 12 values in the first list, and to get the sample mean and sample standard deviation, I'm going to right arrow over to calc, select option 1, and I have my data in list 1, and enter at calculate. So I have a sample mean of 1125.33. And that sample standard deviation will be this value here, this S sub x. So that's 184.67. Okay, and those are rounded to two decimal places. In a little bit, I'll show you how to get the confidence interval directly, but to do this formula by hand, these are the pieces you need. Okay, so plugging into this formula, I have 1125.33 plus or minus this critical value, 1.796, times S1864.67 over the square root of n. Oops, I could put 12 in there. All right, this piece right here will be our margin of error. And I can find that piece separately. So entering into my calculator, I have 1.796 times 184.67 divided by the square root 12. All right, so this margin of error is approximately 95.74. So I want to take the sample mean and subtract this and add it. So subtracting it will give my lower endpoint for my confidence interval. So using my calculator, 1125.33 minus, I'll just carry it down from the previous line. So the lower endpoint of my confidence interval will be 1029, and I'll round to one decimal place, 0.6 up to, I did it again, 1125.33 plus that margin of error. You could carry it out a little farther if you'd like. And rounding to one decimal place, I have 1221.1. Okay, so this will be a 90% confidence interval for mu, my population mean IQ scores. Okay, so these are the pieces you would need if you were to do this by hand. If you wanted to get this directly from the calculator, in other words, you wanted just to jump right to the confidence interval, it's pretty easy to do. Okay, if you didn't have the data set already put in a list, you'd definitely want to do that. I did that previously. And after that, you press your stat button, right arrow over to tests, and you want to scroll down to the T interval. Okay, we're finding a confidence interval for the mean when sigma is unknown, so we want to use the T distribution in constructing that interval. And I'll have two options. Either I'll have the raw data in a list, which is what I have, or I'll have the summary statistics, which I could use since I found those already. And my data is in list one, so I can leave that alone. And I just need to change my level of confidence and enter. And let's compare that to what I got by hand. It's a little blurry, my apologies. The lower endpoint from the built-in T interval function is 1029.6, and the upper endpoint is 1221.1, which is what I got when I rounded to one decimal place and I did that by hand. So it's always convenient to use technology, but it is good practice to do a few of these by hand, just so you know and understand where these pieces come from.